Let's sing together this morning with gladness. Oh, come all ye faithful,
joy and triumph. Oh, come ye Lord, come ye to
glad that you are here this morning. We're here to give praise and honor to God as we worship Him. If you would, pray with me as we begin. Father, you are good, and thank you so much for this new day. Father, we come before you, not that we are not always before you, Father, but this morning we assemble as your people, as your body, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, we pray that you would use our lives this week to reflect your goodness into a world that simply needs your goodness. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for your spirit that dwells within us. We pray we would look like Jesus to someone. It's his name that we pray. Amen. All right, let's continue singing together.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Glory.
the herald
angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, the dead sinners reconciled. Holy is
Elizabeth said, Mary, your Lord is dwelling within you now. So I would say even Jesus, Lord, before birth. Beautiful picture. Let's sing this together.
Holy night. Till the end.
this song before the Lord's Supper this morning. Born a king on Bethlehem's
name, gold I bring to crown again. King forever, ceasing never, over us all to reign. Oh, star of wonder, star of night, star in glory.
Please bow with me. Our Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us, all that you've blessed us with, and all that you've given to us. Thank you for letting us be here this morning to learn about you and this time that we have to remember the sacrifice that you made for us, not because you had sins or blemishes on yourself, but instead because you knew that we do and that we always will, and that we need that sacrifice to cover us. We need your blood to continue to cleanse us. As we take this unleavened bread, help us remember your son's body as it hung on the cross. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. remember as we take this fruit of the vine, and help us to never forget his sacrifice. It's in our Savior's name we pray. Amen. Lord, thank you for the blessings that you've given to us, the spiritual blessings, the physical blessings, the simple things such as just waking up this morning and being greeted by a beautiful, beautiful world. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have done and have promised to do. Help us, Lord, as we give back to you what's already yours, to do so in a way that is bringing joy in our hearts and thankfulness for just what you've showered us with. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, this is the Word of God. Colossians 1, 18 through 20. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Join me in prayer. Almighty God, thank you that through the efforts of millions and millions of Jews and later Christians, your powerful word has been preserved. These precious saints of yours took exceeding care in handling your word as they copied it to the absolute best of their ability. Thank you that we have the word of God unvarnished before us this day, whereby we can learn how to serve you, our God, to worship you, our God. Thank you for our elders that demand that we read your word in our worship services and as often as we can. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, if you would, stand. This is the song before our lesson this morning. Joy to the world.
Good morning. It is good to be with you this morning. If you're visiting with us, we want to invite you one more time to fill out a visitor's card. We are glad that you're here and want you to know that you're welcome. We'd love to have a record of your attendance. You can find one of those cards in the back of the pew in front of you, and you can leave it on the round table in the foyer, or you can pass it off to somebody in person. We'd love to have the opportunity to shake your hand and meet you face to face. We believe that Spring Creek is a place that you will see Jesus. I want to remind you of a couple of things. That is, the food pantry is continuing to collect items, and we continue to have folks that come out to get those, and that's a huge blessing. You always do a great job, but the list is still there. The cart is full in the back, and that's a regular occurrence. Again, thank you for the way that you look like Jesus in that way. This is the QR code for the Google form that says whether or not you're going to attend the LTC preparation meeting. So you can get out your phone now and do that if you want to go or you're not going to go. Or you can find that same QR code in your bulletin this morning. And this is the information lunch where we learn all of the stuff that we're going to do and where we're going to go and what is going to happen and how we sign up and all of that. So I'd encourage you, if you have a 3rd through 12th grader, to be there for lunch, to be there for the meeting. LTC is a great opportunity to train our young folks to be leaders in the Lord's church. Remember that the holiday party is coming up this week, and so you'll want to get your tickets this morning, and they're still on sale in the foyer. And again, there's a QR. See, night is our first fellowship meal, and so it's chili and baked potatoes. So if you've not signed the list in the foyer on the round table, you need to do that this morning. All of the Arms of Hope gifts and donations from the Christmas tree are due in today. And so we're going to collect that box and move out with it. So if you've not brought your gift yet, if you've not brought your star back, then today's the day to do that. There are giving stockings for kids located in the foyer. The note that I have says, grab a stocking, buy the presents for the child on the stocking, and the presents need to be wrapped and brought back to the building with the stocking information attached by December the 15th. And so this is a great way to reach out to folks that are in our community and folks that we know to help out at Christmas time. And so remember that you're going to wrap those, bring them back. We do have to have the stocking information connected so we know who it goes to. Since it's already wrapped, we don't want to guess at it. So if you'll do that, you can grab a stocking this morning in the foyer. Tonight is our first Sunday night, so we have a special Sunday night speaker, and tonight it's David Halaska, and he's got something planned for us, and I'm excited to... And then I'm going to invite you to turn over to Luke chapter 2 this morning. Luke chapter 2. We started last week talking about what it means to have a heart for the season, or what is at the heart of the season. We are in the Christmas season. We are in a time when there are some words that float around and there are some feelings that float around, and we talk about Jesus. Now, we understand that Jesus is the heart of every season. And the challenge that we face during the year is to embody what the heart of the season is, to embody who Jesus is, not just now when it's sort of a popular thing to do, every season of our life. So last week we talked about hope, and we talked about Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, and we talked about the promise of a child to come. This week we're going to talk about peace. And the aim for us this morning is to recognize that Jesus brings peace to the world in every season of life. I'm going to encourage you to hear the story of the shepherds this morning and then to recognize in a list format, make a list, the ways that Jesus brings peace into your life, because we're going to talk about how peace affected the lives of the shepherds and those around them this morning. But we identify with that, and we want to identify with that. We want to place ourselves in that story, because when the Bible speaks and it talks about folks, it speaks to us and it speaks to our season in life and speaks to what it is that we're about and what is it we're going to do. The aim ultimately is to find a way to share that peace that we understand with others this week. And so that's our task this morning. In Luke chapter 2, we are introduced to this group. This first sort of mass message goes to a group of shepherds. Now, I have... in my time in ministry, preached about shepherds being dirty and being mean and being inglorious and being sort of this on the fringe of society and being on. But as I have grown and continued to study, I'm not entirely sure that's true. The popular opinion is that the shepherds are sort of this rowdy group of people on the outside. And you'll hear that over and over, and you can pick up good commentaries and read that. I'm not interested in arguing that too much. But that's not the biblical picture of a shepherd, is it? When we look at a biblical picture of a shepherd, we have to come away from sort of the sources that we use. We come away from Aristotle, who lived 300 years before Jesus in Greece, not in Israel, right? He talks about shepherds as dirty and mean. Philo lives in Egypt at the time of Jesus. His quote is, "Shepherds are mean and inglorious." And so if you go back into his day and translate those words, not in our current vocabulary, which would mean they were not nice and they were kind of rough, what Philo actually meant was that they were common people. They didn't hold a position. They were inglorious. When we get to look at that kind of stuff, we begin to get a different understanding maybe of what's going on. Because biblically, shepherds are good guys. I mean, think about it for a minute. Abraham, the father of the faithful, the father of the Jewish nation, was a what? He was a shepherd. He had flocks. He had sheep. Moses is called out of Midian. In fact, he meets God at the burning bush as he's doing what? Shepherding sheep. King David, before he was a king, before he was someone of great importance, before he fought a giant, was doing what? Shepherding sheep. Isaiah, when he speaks about leaders, God's leaders, he speaks about shepherds. When we talk about those elders in Israel that God calls to be leaders, we see pictures of shepherds, folks who care for sheep. See, shepherds might be rough because they work a rough job. They work in the field. They work with animals. Do they stink? Probably, right? My grandmother used to say, if you lay down with dogs, you get up with fleas, right? Now, she'd also like to say, and you also smell like dog. And so if you work with sheep, guess what you smell like? Sheep. And so that can be stinky if you don't like sheep. If you really like the smell of sheep, it's a glorious thing, right? It's just depending on what you like. So to say they were dirty, to say they were smelly, to say they could be kind of rough, sure, that's the kind of job that they worked. But think about the biblical picture of shepherd. A shepherd is one who is attentive to the flock. A shepherd is one who knows his sheep and their names. He knows their habits and where they go. He is the one who is willing to face danger to protect his sheep. The shepherd is the one who binds up the wounds of a sheep. The shepherd is the one who carries a sheep when it can't walk on its own. There is a gentleness. There is a protectiveness. There is a nurturing aspect to shepherds, right? This is the group that we find in Luke chapter 2, verse 8. We have a group of men who are shepherding sheep. They are out there and they are listening to the sounds of the night and they are talking amongst themselves and they are minding their own business. They are listening for danger. They're attentive to what it is that's going on. And then all of a sudden, in my mind, and I think in the pictures we have, they sort of have this bright light experience, right? How many of you ever come out of the movie theater and are shocked that it's still daylight? Do you do that? This is kind of the look on the shepherd's face. They're sitting there in the night, they're watching sheep, and all of a sudden there is a presence among them. There is something that's going on that's there, and it is a surprising thing. It is surprising enough that they are in fear, right? I mean, Luke says that the glory of the Lord shone around this angel who appeared. This angel sort of shows up, and the shepherds go, there is something wrong. There is something here that's out of the ordinary. There is something here that could make us afraid. Now remember, this is a group of men who are used to fighting for their sheep, right? I mean, let's go back a little ways. David fought the lion and the bear. You can't be timid and fight a lion, right? In fact, they still sell tickets at the circus because they have lion tamers, right? Big, ferocious kind of deals. Bears. We can talk through the text about how shepherds protect from wolves. We can talk about this idea of predators. These guys are not sort of scaredy cats. These guys are not timid. But when an angel of the Lord appears, when God shows up or God's messenger shows up, these guys are afraid. There is a sense of awe. There is a sense of power. There is a sense of the unknown. There is something that's going on. And they say, what are we going to do? How do you stand in this place? How do you deal with this? Now, when we're defining peace, fear doesn't fit in with peace, does it? We talk about peace being the absence of conflict sometime, and there's a truth there. We talk about peace being an awareness of the presence of God, and that's the definition I like most. But there are things that peace does not encompass. Peace does not encompass fear. God does not expect us to live in this overwhelming sense of fear. Nor does He expect us to live in an overwhelming sense of guilt or shame. See, peace with God takes those things away. So the shepherds in this moment have no peace. They're not at rest in God. They're not in a place where they see an absence of conflict. They're not in a place they fear. What are we going to do? How are we going to respond, right? Now, that's something you and I can identify with. That's something that you and I deal with. There are things in life that are scary. There are things in life, especially when we begin to face the unknown, that we get worried about. It can come in the form of a teacher's report for one of our kids. It can come in the form of an announcement from the doctor about our health. It can come in the form of a loved one who is sick. It can come in the form of a job that is unknown tomorrow. There are things that shape our world and make us afraid, that make us nervous, that make us question what happens in the next moment, that bring fear into our lives. Fear is not a place that God wants you to live, right? But it's something that we deal with. And so the recognition of God's desire for peace, I think, is important for us to understand. Why does God send His messenger first to shepherds? Here's why, I think. Because they are common. Because they are inglorious. Because they're everyday folks who work a job. They're blue collar before we ever understood what blue collar was. They hold a job just like we do. They live life just like we do. They're providing for a family. They're living out their normal. They're not kings. They're not leaders. They're not rulers. They are working guys. They are folks who live normal, everyday, inglorious lives. Right? Like a lot of us do. And there are things that happen that they question. There are things that happen that make them afraid. There are things that happen that don't fit into the ordinary of life and that rob them of their peace. And it is to this group of people that God sends a messenger. It is in this context that we begin to see what it is that God wants us to understand about peace in this moment, right? Verse 10, "The angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy,'" glad tidings of great joy, you may read, "'that will be for all the people,'" right? What I want us to understand is that peace begins with good news from God. That peace starts when we listen to what it is that God has to say, right? "I bring you good news of great joy. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Verse 12, "This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." When God shows up, God says, "Don't be afraid," right? Now, how well does that work for you on a normal basis? When my kids come into my room in the middle of the night and they say, "Daddy, I've had a bad dream, and I'm scared," it is the best thing for me to look at them and say, "Well, get over it and go back to bed." Right? Is that what we do? If you do, I'll see you up front in a moment of repentance here, right? That's not what we do as parents. At parents, we understand that in that moment, they need a different message, right? Are their fears often unfounded? Are their fears often in their imagination? Are their fears often fueled by the dark, too much pizza before bed, the wrong kind of show, whatever it is? They're often fueled by a lot of different things, but what they need in that moment is good news. They need a message that will bring some sort of peace. And God understands that about His children. He looks at us in the places that we fear. He looks at us in the places that we struggle. He looks at us in the places where we have no peace. And the first thing He wants us to understand is that there is good news for us, right? The angel's message is clear. There is today, born in Bethlehem, a Savior. There is today someone who is going to walk in your life, who is going to change your world. This is good news. We don't come to tell you something scary. We don't come to take the sheep. We don't come to fight a battle with you. We come to bring you a message from God. We come to calm your fear. But more than that, we come to calm the fear of all humanity, to bring peace to all the world. Unto us a son is born. We go back to that message. We go back to that wording. We go back to what it is. This is Christ who is the Lord, right? That He has come in this moment. And so there is good news about the coming of Jesus. At any moment in our life when we are struggling with peace, one of the places that we as Christian people need to go back to is back to an understanding that we never walk in this world alone. That we never walk into our days, into a place or into a situation that Jesus has not gone before us. And I don't mean simply historically He's experienced something like it. I mean you don't go to your job and beat Jesus there. He is there when you get there. He is there while you are there. He is there when you leave, right? Jesus inhabits our moment. This is good news. This is glad tidings. This is a reminder that Jesus is in those places that affect how we feel or affect what it is that we think that can rob us of our peace. There has to be an awareness of Christ in that place. The good news is that Jesus doesn't just sit there idly, that Jesus is at work. As a baby, He comes and He lays in a manger. You go, well, I've seen babies. What do babies do? Babies sleep. Babies eat. Babies cry. Babies go to the bathroom, right? And that's the four things that babies do, right? And so babies are worthless. You can take that out as a soundbite and I will go, right? Are they worthless? No, they are not. We don't feel that way. But you look at Jesus in the manger, you go, He's a baby. And don't get us wrong, He's a baby. He sleeps, He eats, He cries, He goes to the bathroom, He's a baby. But His presence in this place, His very existence in this place is a moment of peace because God has come. This is a Savior who is among us. This is the culmination of a promise that God has repeated throughout history. The very presence of Jesus brings with it promise, brings with it power, it brings a moment of transformation. And so whatever it is that we experience, this understanding that Jesus is there is more than simply He's sort of in the area. He is at work. He is watching. He is concerned. The messenger knows exactly what the shepherds are feeling, right? And he speaks into that place. Don't fear. I've got good news for you. Verse 13. Suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom He is pleased." And so we have this addition to the message, right? We have going from one angel to a host of angels, to a multitude of angels. And what is their message? Their message is again a message of peace. When we understand that peace grows, when we understand that peace extends, what we get a picture of is that peace is sort of builds bridges between people. That it doesn't rest in just one place. When you have peace, peace by itself, when you experience it, is intended to affect those around you. It's intended to spread out among you. Have you ever been in a situation and something bad happens and there's one guy who seems to hold it together? Who does everybody look to for leadership? Well, we look over here at the guy that's pulling out his hair and is screaming and it's hot. No, you look for the guy who has it together, right? You look for the guy who seems to be at peace. The woman at peace. That's what you're looking for. Peace, by its very existence within the life of somebody, is a message that spreads. One angel brings a message of peace, and then a whole lot of angels bring a message of peace. And they point very specifically, right? Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom He is pleased. Those who God looks at with favor. We just finished a series on the Beatitudes, didn't we? Matthew 5, 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. That peace goes out and transforms who we are, changes who we are. Verse 15, when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." When the angels leave, does the message leave with them? No. Does the peace leave with them? No. They have been touched by peace, and so now they look at each other and go, what are we going to do? We're going to go find the source of this message. Right? They're going to automatically start to build a bridge. We're going to connect with what this message is about. Let's go over to Bethlehem and see what they were talking about. Let's go over to Bethlehem and find this babe who's wrapped in swaddling clothes. Let's go over to Bethlehem and find out who it is that this Savior is that they have announced. Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. Verse 16, they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. When the shepherds went to find Jesus, they found Mary, they found Joseph. And what is it that they tell them? You will not believe the message that we heard. We were out in the fields, minding our own business. And all of a sudden, there was an angel that showed up. And the angel said, don't be afraid, I bring you peace. And then there were a bunch of angels that showed up. And you know what they talked about? They talked about, we're supposed to be at peace. They said, your baby is special, that your baby is the Savior, that your baby is the one who is of the line of David. They said these incredible things about Jesus, right? And Joseph and Mary go, yeah, we know. We were there. We talked to those guys before. We weren't in the field with you, but we've heard the message, right? They understand, but it's still exciting to share. The part about the passage that I love is that Luke says, and all who heard them. We sort of get this picture in our head that the shepherds show up, and it's them, and it's Joseph, and it's Mary, and they all sort of get together, and it's sort of one. That's not what Luke paints. Luke paints a picture that there are some other folks around, which makes sense, right? How many of you had a baby and didn't tell anybody ever? Nobody? What do you do when you have a baby? You know what we do in this day and age? You send out announcements, right? This is the name of the baby. This is the sex of the baby. This is what the baby weighs. This is what the baby measures, right? This is a picture of the baby. This is where you send presents for the baby, right? We send all that stuff out. We want folks to know we've had a child. We hang balloons on the mailbox. We do big yard signs. We have this. It's no different in the first century. You have a baby, people come to see the baby. You have a baby, you tell folks about the baby. The shepherds show up and they share a message of hope with anyone who will listen. And everyone who hears them is amazed at this message. Everyone who hears them begins to think, this is something going on that's over the top, right? And so what the shepherds do is they begin to build a bridge between people to say, let us tell you about peace. Let us tell you about what God does. Let us tell you about the presence of God that's among us. Let us tell you about this Savior that is born. Let us tell you what it is that we've heard. When we exist or when we find peace in this world through Jesus, it is a peace that God intends for us to share. It is a peace that is supposed to build bridges. It is something that we share with other people. We live in a world that looks for peace and cannot find it in the world. We live in a world that struggles to be at rest and to be at calm just in everyday life, right? And I'm going to tell you that the solution to that is found in Jesus Christ and understanding who He is. Does that mean that if I follow Jesus, I will never have another problem in my family? No. Does it mean that I will never struggle with fear again? No. Does it mean that I will never? No. Then what good is it? I'm going to tell you what good it is. It changes the way that you see all of that stuff and the way that you deal with all that stuff and the authority that all that stuff begins to fall under. Jesus transforms how we live and how we interact and how we see those things, right? Jesus is not a get-rich-quick sort of scheme. He is not a we're going to make everything better tomorrow. He is not this magic cure for your bad decisions all of a sudden. He is the source of the transformation that's going to change over time who we are, who shapes and who forms people to be different and to live different who brings into our life a sense of peace so that we can work out with Him what it is that's going on, so that He can change who we are and how we react and how we deal. The shepherds are still guys who live in a field, but they are different now because they have a message to share, and they live in a different place. Sometimes peace changes us dramatically in the moment, and sometimes we have to work at peace a little bit. But the source of peace is always going to be Jesus. And I think that's important to see, because you see, as the shepherds make known this and all the people wonder at it, Luke goes on to say, "But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them." See, peace, as it grows, is not this magic cure, but it is a process. Peace produces transformation, a change in who we are. The shepherds are no longer afraid. They no longer live in fear. In fact, they become people who talk and who share this message. It says that they leave glorifying God, raising God up, because that's what peace does. Peace recognizes that God changes situations, that God changes circumstances, that God changes my perceptions, that God changes my heart. And when I put God first, that's what glorification is, when I lift God up, when I lift up Jesus in my life, my focus is different, right? My direction is different than what it is in the world. The shepherds leave praising God. I love the passage that's tied with that says, Mary pondered these things in her heart. The word pondered there is a Greek word that comes from an idiom that means, I have put my hand to the plow and I'm plowing along, but now I stop and I look back and I check my work. I check to see where I have been in relation to where it is I'm going, right? Jesus will say, those who put their hand to the plow and look back are not fit for the kingdom of God. And he means that in a very specific understanding, but it's the same word, right? And what Luke says is there were times in Mary's life that she had to look back at this moment when shepherds taught her a lesson about transformation. An angel spoke about a coming of Jesus, that He would be the Savior of the world. Can you imagine the moments in life when Mary had to stop and look back? Moments when she heard that there were Pharisees out to kill her son. Moments when she knew that Jesus was sleeping on the ground somewhere, didn't even have a place to rest His head. The moment that she hears that Jesus is on trial for His life. The moments that she hears that Jesus is going to die on a cross. These are moments that you have to stop and look back and say, what is God doing in these places? And Jesus remembers a message from shepherds. And Jesus remembers what angels said. And Mary remembers who Jesus is and what it is that Jesus has come to do. Right? Does it transform the way that she sees life? The way that she sees her son? Does she experience a sense of glorification when she realizes that Jesus has come to fulfill a purpose that's far above anything she may be able to understand? Does it bring in itself, in that time that it's hard, a moment of praise for a God who moves in the life of people? See, these are the signs of peace. When we, in the midst of whatever the world hands out, have hearts that are aligned with God's will and with God's purpose, and that we can rest in those moments and understand how those moments are transformative, how those moments are a glorification of who God is, when we can praise God for what it is that He's doing. Paul would write this kind of message about peace when he wrote to the church in Colossae. He would talk about Jesus, and he would talk about what it is that Jesus does and what it is that Jesus brings. Steve read it for us this morning. I'm going to start in verse 19. For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Jesus is good news from God. God says, I have come to live among you. I have come to be with you. And Paul shares that message, that in Him all of the deity of God was pleased to dwell. When Jesus came, it was God walking on earth. It was God's presence among man. It was Emmanuel, God with us, right? This is what Paul tells the church in Colossae. when they need a sense of peace, to remember that Jesus walked among you, right? He goes on to say, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven. Paul recognizes that Jesus is the bridge builder of reconciliation. That Jesus comes and says, don't deal with stuff on your own. Come to me. Be reconciled to me. Right? Live life with me. This is the invitation of Jesus. This is what brings peace, is to recognize that God desires to walk with us, that Jesus calls for us, that He's building a bridge, that in reconciliation He takes away what it is that hinders us. He forgives sin. He quiets fear. He calms doubt. He brings to us a sense of rest and a sense of peace in a world that is troubled. Exactly what the angel told the shepherds, fear not, I bring you good news of great joy. Those words can still be spoken by Jesus today. Fear not, I bring you good news. I bring you myself to make your lives different, to change who you are. Paul says, when God walked among us, when the fullness of God dwelt in Jesus Christ, Jesus had a mission to perform, and that mission was to reconcile broken man with a holy God. And Jesus continues to do that today. Jesus continues to bring peace to troubled hearts. He goes on to say, there at the last part of verse 20, making peace by the blood of His cross. Peace comes at a price, and Jesus is willing to pay that price. I don't always claim to understand every part of the cross and what it's about. I can tell you a lot about it. I can tell you what I believe about it. But sometimes you look at the cross and you look at the overwhelming love of God, and you have to be reminded of Philippians 4. That what God does is He brings us a peace that surpasses all of our understanding. Right? Why do you send your son to a cross? Well, we can talk about the law, and we can talk about legal fulfillment, and we can talk about love, and we can talk about... But it's a big price, isn't it? But when Paul talks about that, he talks, just like he does to the Philippian church, about a peace that passes all understanding. And I'm not on anymore. So, you don't get it. About a peace that passes all understanding. Right? The peace of God in Jesus Christ is meant to overwhelm us. It is meant to do more in our lives than we can think or we can imagine. It's meant to be more than we can ask for. It is meant to be the solution to our deepest needs, our most fundamental brokenness. Right? It is God's greatest expression of love, is that the blood of Jesus on the cross brings us peace, reconciliation, hope in a world that needs it. And it's not just sort of this academic thing. It's not this thing that we just think about. It is what we feel and what we experience and what we live. We understand what it means to not be at peace. We understand what it means to struggle. God intends us to understand what peace feels like, how we experience peace. In the loss of those that we love the most, God brings comfort and aid. In situations that we don't know where to go next, God brings guidance and direction. In places where we feel hopeless, God shines a light on what is true. This is peace at work. This is how God moves and how God works. It was true for the shepherds in the field. It was true for Mary throughout the life of Jesus. It was true for Joseph. It was true when Isaiah spoke those same kind of words. And it is true today. The peace that Jesus offers is available right now to all who would ask, to all who would seek. in this season, we can talk about peace. And we can hear stories about battles that stop as armies meet together and celebrate and we can meet. But the peace that we talk about in this season, the peace that we talk about in Jesus that's found in every season, is the peace that exists when you are aware of God's work, when you're aware of God's love, when you're aware of God's power in your life. This is the invitation to peace. And if you need to respond to that invitation, we're going to ask you to come, to leave the world behind, to die to yourself in the waters of baptism. We're going to ask you to come in repentance, a change of direction. We're going to ask you to come to Jesus Christ, who is the Savior of humanity, and find the peace that God offers. And we're going to ask that you come right now as we stand and as we sing.
Go tell it.
Good afternoon. Appreciate seeing all of y'all today. Appreciate you being with us. If you're visiting, we're especially pleased that you joined us this morning. Please stick around for a few minutes so we have an opportunity to meet you. If you've joined us online, we also appreciate you being part of today's service. I was going to make a comment or two about early Christmas songs and early Christmas sermon. But it seems that Christmas came early for the Longhorns today, so I guess all that is appropriate. We'll see how it turns out. I think Bill covered most of the announcements. I did want to mention that next Sunday is Cupcakes with Santa, so please plan for that. Plan for coming back. I don't have any updates for the sick other than that Ken and Leslie Walling have the flu, which is why I'm up here today. So keep them in your prayers as well as all of those that you see listed in the bulletin. Do want to encourage everybody to be back tonight to hear David Halaska. I'm sure he has something very, very good for us to hear. So with that, let's have a closing prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're just thankful for being here today, hearing a message of your word, singing praises to you, Father, during this holiday season, we pray that all of us will be safe. We're thankful that much of the world will be thinking of your Son Jesus, will be focused on him. During this time, Father, we pray that all those will grow closer to you, closer to your Son, be looking for a relationship with him, that each of us will use that opportunity to reach out, to encourage others, to just draw closer to your Son Jesus. We're so thankful for his gift, coming to earth, living as a man, suffering for each of us, and for dying for our sins. We're eternally grateful for his sacrifice, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.